everyone. Thank you very much. Can you hear us?
Yeah.
I was going to say, come over and fill the room, but it's already filled, so thank you very much for coming. Today we're going to do a workshop, as we do as every year, but this time we're going to do a workshop building a component with the component dev kit, so you can do it yourself, come along with us, and re-implement it in your components and your libraries. So the thing is, as it's going to work, we're going to show you some stuff, show you the steps that we're going to do, and then you go over, code it with us, and then if you have any question, you raise your hand, we'll come and help you. So we hope you'll enjoy and have a good time.
So, hey everybody. So for those of you that aren't familiar, the CDK or Component Dev Kit is a set of robust, well-tested, and flexible APIs that is at the core of the Angular Material Library. We've put out into a separate package so you can use it to build your own components. It is maintained by the Material team, and it's also as well-tested as Angular Material. It goes through the same rigorous testing process. So the way you can get started to the CDK is you just npm install at angular/cdk. And then you're ready to go. And once you've installed the CDK, you'll notice that it's split up into a bunch of packages. So for example, there's an accessibility package, the bidirectionality portal, overlay, and so on. It's very likely that you won't need all of these packages, but you can pull in the ones that you need. And the way you do that is, so for example, let's say you need the accessibility module. You'd say import the accessibility module from the CDK/accessibility, and then you just put it into your module. And the same goes for the portal, the table, and so on. So I'm just going to go and give a quick intro to the larger modules. So one of the biggest ones is the accessibility module. And it lets you manage focus inside of lists. It lets you trap focus. It lets you figure out like where focus came from into a component. And it also lets you do things like announce text to screen readers or check where something is interactive, and so on. Then we've got the bidirectionality module, or BD. This is used to build components that support both left to right scripts and right to left scripts. So for example, if you're building a slider, you want users to be able to drag from left to right on like in English speaking markets, and then from right to left, for example, in Arabic or Hebrew and so on.
We would use Hebrew, right?
Yeah.
These crazy Israelis.
Then we've got portals. So portals let you take a piece of UI and render it in another place in the app. So for example, you could take a component and you could put it in another place in your app. And what this lets you do is do things like displays in with the overlays. So let's say you're building a dialog. You could say like on consumption, take this content and put it into a dialog. So this is what we do with the overlay entry point, which works together with the portals, and it allows you to position elements either globally on the page, so let's say a dialog, or you could position something relative to another component. So let's say you're building a menu, you could say I want this to be aligned to a menu trigger. Mm-hmm. Then we've got the scrolling entry point, which lets you manage scrolling in a performant way. So for example, it only keeps one scroll listener per page, lets you debounce it, and it also lets you expose the info like the viewport size and so on. Then we've also got a set of unstyled components. So these are the basis of the Angular Material components, but without the Angular Material look and feel, which means that you can take the functionality and implement it to match your UX guidelines. And then we've got a set of smaller APIs that have very specific use cases that you may not need. So for example, we've got the observers, which just let you observe the content of an element, or we've got the layout, which lets you observe the media query, for example. We've got key codes, we've got some testing utilities, text field utilities, and so on. You can read more about this in the docs, but they're very narrow. And with all of that in mind, we can build a color picker component.
So if you will go to this link, most of the components that Kristiyan said we're going to use today in this workshop. So get ready. First of all, it says here clone the clone the repo, but we highly recommend that you use StackBits. We have StackBits links inside the repo, so we can go over there and see right now.
All right.
Yeah. So this is the repository, the Angular CDK workshop. Let's say divided to 9 steps. The last step, which is step 8, is divided to 2 parts because you'll see why. But it's a fairly big one, so we wanted to make it easy for you. Yes, excuse me. Let's do that. I'll give you like a few seconds, minutes to go in. Someone is not ready yet? OK, a few hands. All right. Any objections? This is it. OK. So the Angular CDK workshop, so we're going to build this component that you see on screen right now. It will trigger from the button, if you'll see the final button, the final demo. So there's a button here. It triggers from the button. We can control it from the keypad. And we can select colors. It changes the toolbar and shows us like what color we selected. So it's really cool, really interactive. It also supports bidirectionality. I can show it to you fairly easy. HTML. Yeah. Save?
No, try making a change.
Should work. Oh, believe us, it works. It looks like, no, I think it's something, way. I think it's something with stack bits.
Remove the thing.
Where?
The thing.
No, I yeah. think it's, yeah. If we'll do that. Yeah, you see, StackBits is not a friend of us. Well, if you do it offline, it should work because StackBits is wrapping everything, but it's working, believe us. we tested. Okay, so if we go back to the workshop. Yes, I want to leave. You have a quick jump over there. Go to step 1. And basically, this repository is just Angular CLI, just a new project from the Angular CLI. We just did npm install for Angular material. I'm sorry, for the Angular CDK. There is no material here at all. We wanted to show you that this is a complete separate thing. So there's only the CDK, and so we explain what to do. And what we basically are going to do in this step is we're going to place the header, place some content in it, like the button that we're going to click and everything, and import the overlay that we're going to use in the next step, and we're going to use it, so we want to make all the shell, all the layout of the application ready for to get started using it. So you can go through the step here. I'll make it even bigger for you. And this step is really, really easy. You can just to make you get with it with us, and just we'll give you now like. Let's say 5 to 10 minutes to do it. If you have any questions in the meantime, raise your hand. We'll come and help you. And if you're not going to ask any question, we're going to do it live with you. So go ahead. We'll play some music. And OK. And there you go. Yeah. If anyone has any question, just please raise your hand. And okay, I was going to ask, is someone not finished yet? Okay, sure.
All right, so while you guys are finishing up, I just wanted to give some context about what we're doing right now. So first of all, we added a header, which is what we're going to use to test. So when we build the actual color picker, we're going to be able to change the color of this. Then we also added a button, which is going to act as a trigger for the color picker. Oh, whoops. yeah, so then we also imported the overlay module because we are going to need a few services in order to build the overlay. Afterwards, we added some base tiles. Oops.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So we just added some reset styles that add a nicer font, and then they also add some pre-built CSS that's necessary for the CK to work.
Yeah, in order for the overlay to work, we have a pre-built CSS. What's in there?
So it's a styles that, for example, put everything on top, and it's also the things that, like they add, for example, position absolute to the elements. So that's what this overlay pre-built does.
Yeah. So this is a fairly easy step. It's just the initials of the shell of our application. A header, a button for the trigger to open the overlay from, and I think the trickiest part in this step is this thing that you have to know about, right? The overlay pre-built CSS that includes all the styles for the overlays. That we're going to use, by the way, we're going to override some of these styles later, so you'll just stick with us. So after we finish with this step, let's go to the second step. And now things are getting started real. This is for real.
Yep, so in this step, we're just going to create a component that renders the list of colors and shows them next to each other. And then we're going, afterwards, in the next steps, we're going to take that component and we're going to turn it into an overlay that gets rendered under a button. So in order to do that, first of all, we...
Make it bigger for them to see.
So yeah, we're just going to create a very simple color picker component in which you pass in an array of colors, and it just outputs them for you as squares.
Yeah, I think when we built it, we wanted for you guys to see the way that we built it. This is step by step how we built this component. So in order to make it work as we wanted, we had to build a component first of all, see it on screen, and then create an overlay out of it. So this is the same thing. We're going to create a component that just you're going to see on screen, and afterwards we're going to import it into an overlay. So yeah, go ahead.
Yep, so first of all, we just have to create, if, for example, you fell behind on the previous step, you could just click this demo link, which is going to jump you ahead into a stacked list with the current step.
Yeah. So if for some other reason you were continuing on steps and you are behind and you want to jump back, you can do it for every step. It's binded to stack blitz. So as you can see here, this is the final result of step two. We're just rendering the component and showing all the colors one next to each other.
Yeah, so this is going to turn into a drop down which you click and use the keyboard mm-hmm. to select the colors with.
Yeah. Is there anything interesting about this step? So we just passing into this component the list of colors, and we use ng-style to make the background color. These are some initial styles for the squares, and we import it to the ng model of our application, and this is. You should copy this one. This is a list for material colors that are passed to the are getting passed to the component. All right, and finally, we're using the color picker component here. So again, have 5 to 10 minutes, and then please raise your hands if you have any questions. I'm going to play some music, and perfect. Anyone need some help? Someone is not done yet. Okay, can you go? Okay. So this should be your end result. If you don't see it, you can jump to this step from step two. This is the final demo. And we're going to continue. So basically, as we said earlier, we just implemented. So someone was asking me what's to do with the CDK, but we're doing nothing with the CDK. So when we implemented it, we said, OK, this is we're going to do an overlay. We're going to create a color picker. Let's start by implementing the overlay, to import the overlay. But we're doing nothing with it up until this point. So now we're getting. So now we created the component that we're going to use in the overlay. So in this step, we're actually going to use it. You want to go?
Sorry. So in order to create an overlay, you've got two choices. You can either use a component overlay, in which you basically just give it a class that's a component, and it renders it for you. Or alternatively, you can give it a template, an ng template, and it's going to render the ng template for you. Mm-hmm. And in this case, we're going to use the ng template just because it's a bit easier to wrap your hand around it. The component one needs a couple of extra steps. Mm-hmm. So in this case, first we're going to, in the color picker component, we're going to wrap all the content into an ng template, and we're going to expose it through the color picker's API. As a public property?
Yeah. Just have in mind that by doing so, using the template portal and wrapping your component HTML with ng template, every time that you'll open the portal, it will create a new instance of this template component. Okay.
Yep. So you can see previously our content basically looked like this. Now we just added an ng template around it. Mm-hmm. And then in the color picker, we get a hold of this template, and we expose it as a public property. And we're going to use this template afterwards through the button. And we're basically going to get a reference to it, and we're going to put it into an overlay. Mm-hmm.
So I think in this step and the other steps that are following, we're going to make sure the overlay is working as we want to, and then we're going to create to make it more generic so we can apply this functionality on other elements as well. So currently, we're just focused on making the overlay open and close from the button that we have. So after we got a hold of the template reference, we also add a name for our button so we can use it from the app component. So by doing pound button like that, we can query this button out of our HTML and get the ref element for that. And we're doing that because there's the overlay is a really strong component, or I would call it a service, that you can give it the origin to open from. So if you see here, we're creating an overlay, and we say you should position yourself and be connected to the button that we just got out of the template, out of the HTML.
So if you pay attention to this line in particular, it's a little bit hard to parse when you first see it. But what this says is that I want the x-axis of the button to align with the x-axis of the overlay. Mm-hmm. And then I want the bottom of the button to align with the top of the overlay. So that means like align the start and put it like below. And then we just take this position strategy and we pass it to the overlay service, which gives us a reference to an overlay. And we can use this overlay to open the overlay, to close it, and then to destroy it when we don't need it anymore. Mm-hmm.
We encourage you to just play with this for properties and see how it affects the overlay that we're just going to create. So you figure, oh, this is it. I get what they were saying. So as you can see, we're creating a position strategy, and we're passing it to the overlay config. You can pass other stuff to the overlay config, and you'll see it in a few short moments. But for now, we just tell the overlay, hey, when you open a new overlay, this is your position strategy. This is how you should open yourself.
Yeah, so for example, there's an alternative position strategy called global position strategy, which you can use for something like a dialog. So for example, in here, if you set position.global, it would render it on top of everything, and it would center it based on the viewport rather than relative to the button.
Yeah. So last thing I think we're going to do is we're going to implement the click functionality for the button. So every time you click it, it will open a new overlay. So as you can see, we're getting a reference of the overlay. And we first thing we'd say, delete yourself. If you're there, delete yourself. We don't want you. We're going to create a template portal, as we spoke about earlier. So we're passing the picker that we just. I'm sorry, let me get it back. So this line here, this view child color picker component, allows us to get a hold of the color picker component that we just wrote in our HTML. And now we have a reference to the picker. And we can get the properties from of the picker in the app component. So if you remember when we exposed the template, now we can initiate an overlay with this template from another place. And this view container, you want to explain about it?
Yep, so the view container, so what this does is that it tells Angular where in sort of the component tree the component that you're creating should live. So when we say, when we inject it in here, it means that it's going to live in the same scope of the Angular app as the button that's triggering it.
So yeah, we're just detaching the old overlay ref. We're creating a new portal with the template in this tree hierarchy. And then we attach the speaker to the overlay ref. And last thing to do is just click, add the click functionality to the button. So if we take a look at step three here, we can see that when I'm clicking on the button, it opens the portal for me. And every time I click it, it recreates, it's detached and recreates the component. This component, and after I'm clicking, it's not the same component. It's a different one. You don't see it blinks because it's fast, and it's not closes because we never tell it to detach without creating a new one. If we'll say, so yeah, I wanted to show you detach, but we're going to do it in step four. So this should be your end result, that every time you click the button, it recreates the portal. There you go. You have, like, again, 5 to 10 minutes. We'll play some music, and if you have any questions, then just raise your hand.
Yeah, and also if you want to see example of the positioning, so let's say we wanted this overlay to go up on top of the button, you could say, I want the origin...
Y-axis?
Yeah, we want the origin top to be aligned with the bottom of the overlay. So when we swap this, now it just goes on top. And you can use this, for example, to specify a list of fallback positions. So for example, if, like, on the bottom, if it didn't fit into the viewport, the CDK can flip it automatically and go to the top.
Yeah. OK, so go ahead. We'll be here around.
Yeah, also there was a question from the crowd how, for example, let's say you didn't want this to align flush with the button. You can also tell it to have an offset from its position. So, for example, in here, let's say we wanted it to be 10 pixels above the button. You could say width offset y, and it just pass in a number. And you can see now it's offset.
Is someone not finished yet? Okay. All right. So this should be the final result that you click, and it opens an overlay. And if you played with the position strategy, then it should be some other place. And for the next step, we're going to talk about something that we did in Material. And then I think this what differentiate Material. Angular Material and Angular JS Material, the way we thought about opening up panels and stuff like that. So so what we're going to do next is something we call trigger. It's just a way that we came up of separating the component or the button or the input that triggers the panel or whatever it is. Because if you remember, if you were using AngularJS Material, everything was the same component. You'd have the MD menu, and inside of it, you have the button for this MD menu. So here, we wanted to separate it so you can have the panel that is getting opened somewhere else in your code, and you can just tell which button to open it. So we're going to take all the functionality that we wrote in our app component. We're going to cut it, literally just cut it from the app component and move it into a new directive called the color picker trigger. And this directive enables us to get some of the stuff that it will do some of the stuff automatically for us, just as binding to the click button to the click of the host or getting the actual element that we're going to open the panel from. So this is not complicated, but it's just a different set of mind that if you want to open your own modules, in your own panels, your own overlays, then you should think about doing this this thing.
Yeah, and the nice side effect of it is that it also allows you to use the same color picker with different triggers. So let's say you wanted to have like 5 different buttons on the same page that open color pickers, you can have them all point to the same color picker.
Yeah, the same panel.
Yeah. Yep, so as you can see in this step, we're just taking the logic more or less verbatim, and we're putting them into a new directive called color picker trigger. And what this trigger does is that we just pass in the curl picker that we want to open, and then the trigger manages the overlay for it.
Yeah, if you'll see the HTML for that, sorry that I'm going fast, that this is the API of this trigger. We're going to bind and pass the trigger our color picker. This is a reference to the color picker that gets into the trigger. And that enables us to actually integrate with the color picker itself through our directive. And you can see it, this is the input, which it's the same name as the directive itself. And this is and we're getting out of it the color picker component.
Yeah, this is sort of a nice pattern when you're building a directive that only does one thing. You can just bind it to the same selector, mm-hmm. which just reduces the API surface. People don't have to remember two attributes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this code is basically the same. The only thing that we changed here is since you are getting the overlay ref inside of this this trigger, we wanted to make sure that we are not initiating the color picker. I'm sorry, the portal and the overlay every time that we are clicking the button. So we created an init function, and we moved all the code into there. And that now we check if there's an overlay ref init, and then detach and attach. Also, yeah, we're adding on the directive host the click binding, just like that. And that enables us to just call the click function that we created here down below without even specifying it in the template. So it happens automatically for us.
Yeah.
Also, a nice thing that we get out of it is that in the constructor, we can inject the element ref of this trigger that we're just using. And that way, we don't have to name the trigger again.
Yeah, and we don't have to mess around with view children and mm-hmm. pass memory IDs and all that.
Yeah, and we just connect the overlay to this element ref that we just got. And this is fairly very nice. We need to add it to the app module. And then if we'll take a look again at the app component, it just what we had earlier. We just have the data that we're going to pass to the color picker. So this is only the data right now. And it also simplifies our HTML from what we had before that. We had to name the button and everything. Now we can just say color picker trigger for this color picker.
Yeah, and this also lets us expand really easily. So for example, what we showed before is that you could click the button and the overlay stays there. But in most cases, you also want it to close. So for example, in this here we can start adding the backdrop.
Right.
So in the overlay config, we can say that it has a backdrop, and this means that it's going to render a transparent element behind everything, and we can use that to say when the user clicks on the backdrop, we want the overlay to close, mm-hmm. and we can also pass in more options like the max width, so it's not just one list, long list of colors, but it's actually like a square. Mm-hmm. And then you should keep in mind this backdrop class. So by default, the CDK backdrop is just an opaque
black.
So it's black with like 50% opacity, but you can tell it to be transparent.
This class over here is something that's getting from the pre-built CSS of the overlay. So this is a transparent backdrop out of the pre-built CSS.
Yeah, and then once we have a backdrop, we can subscribe to the backdrop click observable, and we can say that we want the overlay to detach when the user clicks on the backdrop. Mm-hmm.
So that every time the user clicks outside of the overlay, it just closes it. We also want to add the flex wrap into the container of the color picker, because as if you remember, and if you look at it here, we have all the colors spread one after another, and we just set the max width of the container to be 250 pixels. So we want them to wrap and go one line after another until they can't fill anymore. So by just adding this flex wrap, it just do it automatically for us. And that's it. If we look at the demo for this, the final result of this step, it should be even more related to what we saw in the first place. So we have this color picker right now, and if we click outside, it just closes it. And every time I click outside, it closes. Click the button, it's creating a new panel. Yeah, anything you want to add?
No, so if anybody has any questions, just raise your hand.
Yeah. Transparent gray background?
So if we will go to, the question was if it was supposed to have a an opaque?
The overlay,
yeah. So the overlay have a background by default, but that's what we were saying, that this class over here is overriding this and remove the backdrop for that, because we didn't want to that backdrop just specifically. So by adding the override class, we just get rid of it.
Yep. So what this class does is just says opacity 0. You could as well just define your own class in here. Mm-hmm. This is just something for convenience.
Yeah. Is there a way to? So when you're the question was if there is there a way to not make the backdrop hide or be on top of the button that we're clicking. So there's no way. You're using a backdrop. The backdrop is catching the focus and the scroll and the all the click events. That because you're if we remove this one again, you can see it's right on top of it. You can tell it to have pointer events none, and then it will transfer the click event to the background. But then, why would you use a backdrop?
So this is sort of up to you. So, for example, if you don't want a backdrop, you could implement the click functionality yourself, but it's not something that comes baked into the CDK.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So we'll give you some time to do the exercise, and we're here for questions. Hey, are you done? Someone not finished yet? Okay. So if we'll go back here. All right. So once again, we just had a trigger. If we'll see the end result, we created now a trigger that can automatically for us open the color picker. Okay. So in this step,
So now we're actually going to make the color picker pick colors, which is kind of the point. So the first step is having a property that's going to hold the selected color. So in this case, we just decided to make the indigo color like pre-selected. Mm-hmm. So we assign it to the new property, and then we also assign the object to this array. One thing to keep in mind is that we wanted to keep it simple, so we made it compare the objects by reference. So that's why we just didn't copy-paste this object into the array, because comparing them wouldn't be accurate. Then next up, we have to add a value input to the color picker, which lets us pass in the selected color down into it. And we just say add input value, and we say what type we want. And afterwards, we can update our app component to say that to pass in the selected color into the color picker. Mm-hmm. So at this point, we've got a color picker that just knows which color is selected, but it can't propagate the color that you've selected back into the containing component. Yeah, so if you want to make that value binding into a two-way binding, we have to add an output whose name has to be like, for example, value change. This is sort of a pattern with Angular where it's property name change, which is going to turn it into a two-way binding. Mm-hmm. So we create an output that's called value change, which is an event emitter, and then we create a select method into which we pass in the color that wants to be selected, and then we just emit the value back up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so then we just, when you click one of the colors, it's going to trigger the select functionality with the selected color, and then we just change the app component, color picker component, to be two-way data binding with bananas in a box for the value. Yeah, do you know bananas in a box? That's the way to remember the two-way data bind. So we're just going to two-way data bind it to the selected color, and then every time we're going to click each color, it will propagate and change the color. So in order to to know which color is selected, we're going to add this SVG of the check mark inside of the div, just so we can look better. And also we can add, where is it? So you also, I think we did it, you can add like a text or like a span that shows the selected color so you can see that it actually gets selected. And we want to override the SVG fill to be white and to make the cursor when you over the colors that should be pointer. So you can, if we look at it right now, it doesn't seem clickable, but if we add this cursor pointer, it just looks like you can click on it. And the last thing we want to do is actually make the overlay close once you selected a new color, because you don't want it to, you just interacted with it, you finish your interaction and you want it to be closed. So we're going to listen to this color picker value change event emitter, this observable, and we're only going to take the first element out of it, because we don't want to get the entire observable. And every time we get the observable out of it, the new event, we're going to detach and close the overlay. Yep. You have anything to add about it?
So we just want the first thing here, just so we don't have to unsubscribe and resubscribe all the time. It just makes it a lot more convenient. Mm-hmm. And then finally, we can also add a nice transition to the header, so we can see the color changing. And if we scroll back to the top, we can see the result.
Right. I think we also forgot to mention that we are binding the header background color with ng-style to the selected color value. So now we can see that this, the header color changes once we click on a color. So and you can see we added the span here, and then every time we click a color here, it changes and it transitions within the color. Okay, so go ahead. After this part, so you might think for yourself, like, okay, now I have everything's working and it seems nice, but like, what next? What can possibly like be next? We're going to add the RTL support because we want to support the RTL speakers and writers. We're going to add accessibility, which is super important, and we're going to add animations so it can look super lit, as they say now. I forgot anything else that we're going to add? No, so these three things that will make this component like the complete component, because right now it may look nice, but it's not complete yet. So go ahead, implement this step, and we'll be back in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Is there anyone who's still doing it? Yeah, okay. So we're falling back, falling on time just a bit. So we're going to not rush it, but just we're going to take a shorter coding time. So next thing we're going to do is fairly easy, and it's nothing to do with the CDK, but it's super cool. So why not? We're going to add animations for this component. Well, I lied. There is something with the CDK that we're going to use, but that will be on the RTL stuff. So we're going to bind the RTL to the animation origin. But for now, let's make the animation. So.
Yep, so the first thing you need for the animations to work is that you need to import the browser animations module, which lets you do those @ animation name bindings. And then we're going to define our animation trigger. Mm-hmm. So we're just going to call it picker, but you can call it whatever you want.
Right.
Which is going to have a default state of void, which just means it's going to be 0 by 0 pixels, and it's going to be opaque. and we're going to say when it transitions between anything and void, it should become opacity 1, and the
when you're not specifying transform, it just overrides it to nothing, which means show the regular U. Yeah. So it just overrides the scale 0 from scale 0 to nothing.
Yeah, and we say we want the animation to be 150 milliseconds with a nice easing curve. Mm-hmm. So which what this means is that it's going to go something like this, so it's going to expand and it's going to fade in at the same time. Mm-hmm. And so now once we have it defined, we can just add this add picker. This means add the picker state, mm-hmm, to the container, which means that it's just going to transition in once the container gets attached.
Yeah. And this is the part that we told you that we're going to override later with the RTL stuff. This is telling actually the component when you're animating, your origin of animation should be from the top left because this is where it opens from. This is where the button is. So for now, we're just going to say, okay, open from the button and do like that. If we look at the demo, and I think animations speaks for themselves, so you can see it opens and closes really nice. But if we will zoom, okay. But if we remove, zoom, shnia in Hebrew, it's like 1 second, man. Okay, if we remove this one, then you'll see it will open from the center of the component, which looks really odd. So we're just going to say, when you're transforming in, do it from the left top corner of the container itself. So this is like a small part to make it look better. And afterwards, when we will implement the RTL stuff, then we will override this and we will use the RTL service. So we'll give you like 5 minutes. It should be really easy. If you have any questions in the meantime, just call us. But we don't want to make you stay more than you want to. So just go ahead. And listen to the music, and we're here. All right, I know some of you might not have finished. We encourage you to finish it while we're still talking, but we don't want to make it longer. So in this part, we're going to use the BD model, which is basically supporting the RTL and LTR. And I think it's really important to do it, first of all, just because you don't want to do it yourself, to figure which way or which direction is your application right now and stuff like that. And second of all, it just helps you do it really easy, and you can have, with using just the BD model, you can have multiple directions in your application nested because it knows contextually where you're at.
Yep, so what the BD module does is it just lets you determine the direction of a particular element. So the way you do it is that you just inject this directionality service, and what it's going to do is going to go up the DOM, basically, mm-hmm. and whenever it's going to return the direction of the first element that it hits, and if it doesn't hit anything, it's just going to take it from the HTML. Mm-hmm. And so the way you consume it is that, first of all, you import it, then you need to pass it into the overlay. So what this does is that it's going to give the same directionality to the overlay as the button, which means that if the button is inside of an element that's RTL, then the overlay is also going to be in RTL. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, we also have to pass it to the position strategy with this with direction method. This is necessary because the CDK figures out automatically how to align it. So for example, in LTR, the start means to the left, but in RTL, it means to the right. And by passing it in here, you're telling the CDK to handle it for you.
Right.
Yeah, and then finally, we can use the same directionality to say that the animation should start from the top right when you're in RTL. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the top right or the left top. I think I want to show it to you because it didn't work before that, but I think I know how to fix it. I think what we can do here is wrap this div with your RTL, and I think this one might work. Okay, so.
No, you need to do it on the index HTML.
Yeah, but it didn't work before that.
Try again.
Maybe here.
No, just on the index, on the HTML. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Just to make sure, I'll put it some in many places. Maybe it will do its job. All right. So I think it's just something which said that StackBlitz wraps everything. But this step is really just about getting the right direction from the directionality service and apply it to whoever wants it. So as we said, the overlay and the position strategy of the overlay wants to know about it, and also the origin of the animation. So actually, I don't think we should give time to do it because you can see it's like using a service, and we can go to actually what we all here for, which is the accessibility, right? So yeah. If we'll take a look back again, this is the end result. Nothing actually changed. This is not it. Nothing actually changed unless we were using an RTL website. So what we want to do next is to actually enable for users to go with the keypad, and if they hit spacebar or enter, they can just select the color, because this is what we expected out of it. I mean, when you are developing a component, you want it to be as user friendly as you can, because if it's not, then they're just not going to use your component, or they're not going to use your application. So when you're developing websites, or when you're developing components, think of the user or what the experience you wanted to have out of it.
Yep, so we've split up the accessibility into two steps because it can be a little bit tricky to get right. So first of all, we're going to start off with just with some foundational work to make it easier for the next step to create the full accessibility story. Mm-hmm. So first of all, we need to import the accessibility module, which gives us a set of accessibility utilities like managing focus and trapping focus and handling, for example, like moving focus with the arrow keys. Then in order to be able to use the CDK's keyboard management, we need to split out the individual color squares into their own component, which implement this focusable option interface. So basically what we're doing is creating a new color component, and we're taking the template of the color and put it in there. And we're also going to add a couple of inputs like the color that it's representing and also where that color is selected. And this is the important part. We need this focus method. Yeah, we need this focus method because this is what the CDK is going to call when this element is supposed to be focused.
Yeah, this focusable option is what it's just the interface that says if you want to make this component focusable by the key manager, you have to give it a focus function, and that it will inside of it figure which element you should give the focus to.
Yeah, you will see later on that this makes it a lot easier to then just hand over all control over keyboard
right. Keyboard
accessibility to the CDK. So yeah, you can see we extracted the template, and then we also extracted the component CSS. This also has a nicer side effect of making our color picker smaller, which makes it a little bit easier to reason about. Mm-hmm. Yep, so we create the component, we declare it inside the module, and then in here we just repeat over the color component instead of repeating over a div.
Right.
And then now once we have the once everything is set up for us, we can use the focus key manager. And what a key manager does is that you give it a query list. You might be familiar with query lists if you've used view child or content child. You give it the list, and then you pipe all of the keyboard events to it, and it keeps track of which element is selected. It also does wrapping. It supports LTR and RTL. Mm-hmm. So the way you consume it is, first of all, we're going to create a property in which we can store it. Then we're going to take hold of all the view children. So this is why we need it in a separate component, so we could query it. Mm-hmm. Yep. And then after the color components are initialized, we just say we want a new focus manager with this set of colors. We say that we want it to be horizontal, so this means that it's going to support left arrow, right arrow. You could also say that we want it to be vertical as well, so it would do up arrow, down arrow, but in this case it doesn't make sense because it's a grid.
Yeah. In this case, what Christian was trying to say is that it supports the focus key manager supports lists which are flat. If you have an item one next to another, so if you have it horizontally or vertically, it will go one after another. But since we have here a grid, it doesn't make sense to have support up and down. You have to specify this logic by yourself. So we said, okay, let's support left and right. So if we hit the wall here, it will go to the next one because it in his mind of the focus key manager, they're all flat, and we will later add the functionality of going up and down.
Yep. So in the next step, we're going to.
This is the next step. Yep. Going up and down. Yeah.
Yep. So next up, we have to tell it from which element it should start. So when we say set active item, this means that once it's initialized, it's going to put focus on the selected value if we have one. Mm-hmm. And this is what we do in this. We just check where we have a selected value and where we have a key manager, and then we just assign the active item. Mm-hmm. And also, this is the important part. This is what actually makes it work. We say that on every key down event, we want to pipe the key down event to the key manager so it knows what to do.
Or when to trigger.
Yep. Yeah. Then we need to add this ng-onChanges hook. So what this does is that it's going to tell the key like when the user selects something, it's going to tell the key manager now this is where focus should start next time the user opens it. Mm-hmm. Yep, so this is just a very easy
just
way.
Just setting the ground for the next time you open the color picker. It's like saving the state of the color picker.
Yep. Then the next thing that's very important for accessibility is having managing focus. So the first step to that is having a tab index on each color. This makes sure that the color is focusable. And you know this ternary here. This means that the selected color is going to be the first one in the focus order. And then the other ones are minus one, which means that if the user presses tab, they won't move to the next color, mm-hmm. because we want them to be able to move with arrows instead of with tab.
Right.
And then finally, we want to trap the user's focus inside the overlay. This means that, for example, if the user opens the overlay and just presses tab, the tab isn't just going to go behind it, but it's actually just going to stay within that overlay. And this is also very important because it could be very confusing if you have an overlay and then your focus somehow managed to slip behind it.
Mm-hmm. So it just captures the focus. So your user, when he hits tab, it doesn't go to other places that you don't want him to go. If he opens it makes sense. If it opens the color picker, you want his focus to stay in the color picker itself and not go to other places or other buttons that you have in your website.
Yeah, and one thing to keep in mind is this CDK trap focus auto capture. So this is a nice way that the CDK traps for so what this does is that's going to find the first focusable element inside the focus trap, and it's just going to focus that element. And this means that you don't have to trap focus by yourself. The CDK just does it for you whenever the color picker gets initialized.
Yeah. So you're just adding to the container. This is a trap of focus. The container of the color picker is a trap of focus. It just traps the focus. And also, you should try and capture it by yourself automatically. Yeah. So we'll give you like 10 or 15 minutes to do it. It's fairly big. It's fairly big. If you have any questions about focusing and stuff like that, just ask us. Right, is there anyone who hasn't finished yet? This step? Okay, we're going to go to the next step, which will be the last step for today. So up until far, we have managed to get a color component, step 8a, a color picker component which opens up every time we click a button. We can control it by the keys. But now we want to add the functionality to go up and down and hit enter or space. But it looks good, to be honest. Like, it's really intuitive and it's really user friendly, I would say. So in this last step, we're going to do some hacks, I'd call it, just to make it happen, because we're using grid right now and not a list. And also, we're going to add something that is really important for accessibility, for screen readers and all this stuff. We're going to add the aria label. And this aria label here, by just saying that, then all the screen readers can go by and read this out loud.
Yep. So the way it's working right now is that focus is managed correctly, but when a screen reader user just opens it, they're not going to hear anything. Yep. And that's because, one, it doesn't have the aria label, and two, it doesn't have the proper HTML structure. So the proper way to do it would be to arrange them into an actual grid and add the grid cell row, the row, and the grid row.
Yeah.
So first we just add the aria label. By itself right now, it still won't actually do anything, but we add it so we don't forget about it later. And then this is a little bit of a tricky part. So in order to be able to render the grid as basically as rows, we need to rearrange our flat array of colors into a 2D array. So this is what we're doing here. We're adding a row size input. This is optional, but it makes it a little bit more customizable. So for example, somebody that's consuming it might want the grid to be 2x2 or 5x5.
So you can see here that we have the color picker. We can say row size 5 or 6, how do you do? Go ahead. So 2, and then it will.
Yeah, it's just going to render a 2x2 grid instead of a 4x4, 4x whatever.
Yeah. So it just works, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, so you don't really need to think about this logic too much. It basically just splits a flat array into an array of arrays. And now that we have our data in a format that's easier to iterate over, we have to rework our repeater. So there's a lot of things to process here. So first of all, on the container, we need to say that it's a row of grid. This is going to tell assistive technologies that this is a grid of things that the user can go through. Then we need a repeater that goes through all the rows. And it's very important to keep the row in here, which also tells the screen reader, it's going to tell the screen reader user like where exactly in the grid they are. So for example, when focus moves, it's going to announce where in the grid it moved to. And then we need another inner repeater, which is just going to go through the colors and render them inside the inside the grid. Yeah, and we need to add the proper row in here. We made a typo in here. The row is actually supposed to be grid cell, not cell.
We fixed it.
It's supposed to be grid cell, right? Like this.
Yeah.
And yeah, which means that now when users go through it with the keyboard, it's going to say cell 1 of 20, row 1, row 2, and so on.
Yeah, you can also see that we added a key down here for the on grid cell key down, and that's for the enter and space. Yeah, we add some styles in order to make it work. The row, so the container will be a column, and then every row will be a flex row. I'm sorry, and we're adding the on grid cell key down, which gets the keyboard event and uses the the key codes from the CDK, which are just a set of key codes that are already mapped to the key codes themselves. So we just, I would call it, I don't know if it's an enum or just like a constants of key codes.
Yeah, it's basically just a bunch of constants. Usually you don't really have to do it, but it makes it easier to support cross-browser.
Yeah.
Usually you could say like event.key equals enter. That would also work in most browsers, but there are some that don't support it.
Right.
Also, one thing to keep in mind is this event prevent default. So what this does is that by default, when the user presses space, the page is just going to scroll down.
Mm-hmm.
This prevents that. And it also means that if this curl picker somehow ends up inside of a form, when the user presses enter, they're not going to submit the form.
Yeah. So we're going to select the color. We're going to call this the color selection. And if we go down, you'll see that we also add the up and down arrow functionality, which is just computing which row it should go when you eat up and down. So. And if you're eating like the ceiling or the floor, it will just stop there.
Yep, so this is very important because when a screen reader encounters a grid, the user is going to expect that the grid supports up and down arrows as well. So you have to account for it in your code.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, so by default, the CDK doesn't give you this up and down arrow functionality, so you have to do a little bit of math just to figure out that it needs to go to the next row or the previous row.
Yeah.
And you can use this API on the key manager to just hook into it.
Yeah, and set the set active item. And that will make actually the selected, when you do up and down, it will do the focus function of each element from that we implemented before. Okay, so that's it. If we'll go and see the final demo that we saw earlier, it's a color picker built completely out of the CDK. It supports up and down, space, and enter. And it looks really good. And it supports RTL and accessibility. And it looks, and the animations are awesome. So I think overall, just within, like I'd say, 1 hour and a half, you created a component, and now you can recreate those stuff that you learned here within all your components, other components.
Yep, and if you wanted to take it a step further, for example, you could say, when I press escape, I want it to close, or when I select a car, I want focus to return to the button. And yeah, you could also make, for example, the rows wrap, so when I hit down, like it would just go
up
back,
again,
back up here. Yep, the CDK is supposed to be very flexible. It adds a little bit of boilerplate, but it just gives you a lot more power.
Yeah, you can go and check the CDK docs at material.angular.io CDK, and you can see here the documentation for overlay, for scrolling, for all the components that we are exposing. And basically almost everything. We're still working on the documentation. We know it's not full yet, but you can get a hold of what we're doing and how to use it from here.
Yeah, and if you don't know how to implement the component, you could look at the Angular material source as well. With all of the material components are implemented using the CDK, so you can use them as a reference. Also, how you can test all the functionality and how you can distribute it and so on.
Yeah. So thank you very much for coming. I was Elad Bezalel. This is Kristiyan Kostadinov. Yeah. And if you have any questions, this is our Twitter handlers. You can just ping us, and we will be happy to help.
Yeah, and we'll hang around for 10 or 20 minutes more if you have any more questions.
Yeah, and you can just grab, if you see us, we're a friend of yours. So just don't be intimidated. Come to us and ask questions. We're here for you. Thank you very much.